Darlings, it's Mummy, Sybil Brunchen, and I'm coming to you live from my back deck here in the main line on the suburbs of Philadelphia. Darlings, I'm doing a little bit of a gardening Tourette, so this is my Tourette, about cycads, about sago palms. They're really not palms. They're actually related more to pine trees, and they are literally millions and millions and millions and millions of years old. Their ancestors lived when the dinosaurs lived. So when you think about a couple of extinctions since then, mass extinctions on this planet, the fact that these plants right here survived is quite extraordinary. I mean, it really speaks to their durability and their ability to adapt and their just dumb luck. But these do look exactly, don't they? They look exactly like something that dinosaurs would have wandered by. All right, so you have three sago palms here, three cycads, and I've saved them to show you how they don't die. They're not dying, but I'm going to show you something. So here's a sago palm in front. So this one right here is very nice. Does it have 20 fronds coming out of it? No, it has three, but it's quite lovely. It's very, you know, it's enchanting. Okay, now, this is what happens with sago palms. Their leaves, or their fronds, age and wither, just like fall leaves would on these trees. Okay, so they become brown and yellow, and they sort of give out, and this is what they become next. Now, just because sometimes only some of them yellow. Sometimes they throw new fronds, which you're seeing right there, even while there are old ones still in good shape. But eventually, these fronds have got to go. They're not immortal. So they do pass, and they become yellow and stiff and die. Now, I was going to show you how you leave them to this point until they're thoroughly dead, and then with a sterile pair of pruners, and you have to make sure they're sterile, so you spray them with some rubbing alcohol, you prune them off, you trim them off, okay? And then you're left with that. That's what you're left with, okay? So you're left with a bare bulb sometimes. All right, that doesn't mean it's dead. Now, what's tragic is that what comets and meteors and earthquakes and volcanic activity and ice ages couldn't kill, housewives from suburbia kill sago palms. So they basically neglect them or whatever, or don't neglect them. But once they get to that point, they just say, oh, well, it must be dead and I'm throwing it away. See, they look at that and that. So no, sago palms go to sleep just like trees do in the winter. We don't cut trees down just because they lose their leaves. We don't say, well, the leaves turned orange and red and gold. Boy, were they pretty and they fell all over the ground and I cut the tree down. No. Well, we don't throw away sago palms. They are dormant. They're just resting. And then this is what happens. Eventually, a month later, 3 months later, whatever, new shoots come up out of the middle. You keep watering them, you keep taking care of them and love them, but they need to rest. And this is what happens. And it's a miracle. It's a miracle. Okay. Now, what I was going to do was I was going to give you a little filmette, a Tourette, and show you one that was in bloom, one that was like this, and then one was like that. And I was hoping that their bio clocks would let this one be the first one to sprout new fronds, and this one would be resting, and you would actually see Mummy trim those fronds off, right? And then it would be bare, and then this one. Well, something happened. Someone's bio clock was off. So this one waited and waited for Mummy to cut those off, and I didn't. And this sago said, I'm sending up new fronds. This one apparently is still sleeping, and I'm going to get some slow release fertilizer. They're pellets. They look like little BBs. And you can buy them online. Look up cycad fertilizer food and you can buy them. And you sprinkle them. That's what you're seeing in the ground. All those little white round things are actually pellets of fertilizer. So, but this is what happens next. Now, I'm going to go get the sterile pruners and trim all of these dead fronds off. And then this will be starting to go and do what it's going to do. Would I like to have 20 fronds? Would I like it to be throwing 20 fronds? Yes, I would, but these are indoor plants. I brought them out on the deck just to show you, but these are normally indoor plants, so they're really not doing what an outdoor cycad would do. Interesting about cycads, they're very slow growing, so these, when I look at the old throws on this, and each of those little points is an old batch of leaves or fronds, This cycad is probably about 40 years old. So these are old. They've been grown in greenhouses and sold, but they've been around for decades looking like this. So you, when you start, you can't cut them open and cut rings, count rings, but you can certainly guess from all those different outer leafy points, like a pineapple, that these must be fairly old, because each of those growth things is like, you're lucky if you get a throw every year. Sometimes a cycad will wait like 2 or 3 years before it throws another throw of fronds. So you, it's interesting. So anyway, that's that case. If you have cycads, please take good care of them. They're not fussy. They are not fussy at all. The watering is easy. They don't need to be repotted. They like being root bound. They really are very, very durable, much more, much less cranky than orchids or other plants like that. But don't throw them away. They go dormant and they need to be just put aside, put them in a spare bedroom or put them, you know, up on a shelf or something where they still get light, still get treated with water and treated properly. And they will do this for you. Okay. So let's not kill them. You know, if comets didn't kill them, it's up to us not to kill them. All right, going on, this is my outdoor deck. And well, darlings, there's my lemon and lime seeds growing. Here's a new little lilac, I mean lavender. Here's my old lavender, which is struggling. Geraniums, look at this. I've never had problems ever with Calibraqua, which is in the front here, the Calibraquas. And over here, I don't know if I've got aster yellows going on. I don't know what's going on. The mums look a little bit tricky. The geraniums look tricky. I don't know if they're getting overwatered or underwatered. But I do think there's something strange, and that's this. We have these beautiful maple trees, and then one looks like it's getting very sick. And before we moved here, there's one down below that died a few years ago of a mystery illness, which I'm wondering, is that what this one is suffering from? And if this is suffering from an illness of some sort, is it getting on my plants on the deck? I worry that we're going to lose that tree in the next year or two. And I've spoken to the groundskeepers here and they've taken a look. And I'm wondering if whatever that is maybe affecting everything. I have never had problems with Calibraqua, which are also called million bells. They look like miniature petunias. They are minimal care and usually lavish blossoms everywhere, certainly out on Fire Island. I don't know what's going on. And this lavender, oh my goodness, it is struggling. Even this geranium is a little bit strange, not flowering like it was. Usually they like this amount of sunlight, and I do not know. I don't know. Mummy's gardening skills are definitely taking a hit this year. I guess the only thing I can point to with pride out here really is these three pots of lemon and lime seeds are perking away and doing well and seem to be puttering on, and I'm glad of that. And I've forgotten what this purple flower is, but this plant that I put in here is still going strong and it has bee visitors every day. So that's amazing, because I didn't deadhead it. The blossom simply hasn't gone yet. So it's been in there for like 2 months. So I don't know. You know, the old saying about gardening, let go and let God. It's so true. You can work and work and work, and there still are the aspects of just dumb luck. It doesn't mean that you should be careless or cavalier in your care of your plants. Plants are depending on us just like animals. You know, when you take a plant into your garden or into your home, you're inviting a kitten or a puppy. You know, it's a being that you are responsible for, and you really have to do your best. If you can't do your best, then don't do that. Just get artificial plants and, you know, have the visual, but don't bring things into your home that, you know, are going to die, because all it does is it messes up your karma, and it really makes you feel on some level careless, and you don't want to feel that because it's not a good place to be spiritually. So anyway, I'm doing the best I can. I'm certainly struggling and reading and looking and getting stuff and trimming and deadheading and making sure I check the soil if it's too wet or too dry. So I'm working through this as best I can. So keep your fingers crossed for Mummy, and please keep your fingers crossed for my nice tree out here. I don't want that tree to go. We love the shade that it brings. It lets just enough sun in and then some shade, and it's lovely. And here are my cycads, and that is certainly, even though it's only two fronds, it's lovely. They're uncurling, and I'll keep you posted. All right, darlings, remember, be in the world and of the world. You know what that means. Be in the world and of the world. And remember, be present, be mindful, be grateful. Everything you see and smell and touch and taste and hear and hold in your hand and your heart, it's all borrowed. It's all only borrowed.